Good morning. Seemed like I was just here, doesn't it? Just close together. It's always great to be with you, and I thank you for coming. I know it's voluntary, and I'm always surprised when people listen as I speak, and I thank you for your courtesy in doing that. This will be one of those messages you won't ever forget. It's on a subject I never heard addressed while I was a student here, because in those days you didn't talk about these things. Isn't that interesting? It's not that they didn't go on, it's that no one felt it was, dignified or appropriate to address these things, and so I didn't hear one message on it. There were occasions I would hear a war story or two, but I never heard the subject really developed from the scriptures. And so I want to do that today because it is an area that will ruin your time at seminary, which is my overarching theme of my time with you. Strange subject to have as a theme, but that also was never addressed. When I graduated, I don't believe I once heard anyone talk about a failing in ministry or suffering real defeat, disappointment. When I first brought a talk on the subject, this theme, I talked about worry, some of you may remember, and how it can steal our joy and our peace if it comes in and haunts us. So I warned all of us about worry and the impact it can have on us. And then the next time we were together, I talked about attitude and how a bad attitude can not only ruin relationships, including those at home, as well as those in the classroom and even in our future ministry, regardless of where God may take us. It's really hard to get beyond an attitude with individuals if they're determined not to change in that area. So I've warned us about that. Last time I talked about a sinister sin, which is a cynicism itself, which can easily grow in a place where there are academic achievements and the desire to do our very best, and in the process we can turn sour on the sensitive subjects of the spirit. And so we talked about the value of guarding against that. Today I want to talk about the secret sins of our lives that have to do with the realm of lust and sex. I want to hit it head on. I want to go directly into it. I don't want to dance around it. I want to talk straight with all of you. And I have in mind both men and women, though it seems to be a greater battle among those of us who are men. And as I think back over the number of times I've had the sad experience of being a part of a gathering where an individual needed to be confronted, and it led to the downfall of that individual's ministry, they've always been men. But I believe women, just as men, can be guilty of lust and can be a part of affairs that occur in our lives. We had a seasoned pastor speak to us in a gathering. We had brought our pastors together in a former church, and we had asked him to speak on whatever he thought would be helpful for us to hear And he began by making a statement I'll never forget. He said, there are four areas, all of them start with the letter S, that become most often the downfall of people in ministry. The first would be silver, which has to do with the whole area of money and greed, how that can turn our heads in the wrong direction. The next is self, where life can revolve around us. In ministry, you're often given a place of authority and you are respected unless you have conducted yourself in a way that has led people to disrespect. But most often they respect you, and in the respect you can let that go to your head, and before long it's all about you. Self can be a real battle. Sloth was the third. In ministry, you are trusted with privacy. You are given the privilege of pretty much shaping your own hours. I don't know of any minister that punches a clock when you come to work and then you leave and people check on your time. And so it can easily become a battle with sloth. Whatever may be your interest, aside from the work of ministry, can become consuming. It can be a hobby. It can be a sport. It can be just plain laziness. And then, of course, the fourth would be sex. And then he went into that subject further and reminded us of the importance of purity. As I talk about this today, I don't want you to think I'm talking to someone else. Even though it may not be for you a real battle, I'd be surprised among the men if it is not one of your major battles. It's everywhere. And it shows up everywhere. Back when I was riding Harleys with my younger son, he and I wanted to go to Tioga, which is a little town north of here. They got great barbecue and it's a nice ride. Back roads are always the best roads on a bike. And I said to him, let's go to Tioga and enjoy some of that great barbecue. The place has burned down since then. But anyway, back then it was a great spot. And he said, great, I've never heard of it. I don't know how to get there. So I pulled up Google Maps, and when I pulled up Tioga, there was a huge statement, sex, that appeared on. Now, I've been to Tioga now, and it has nothing to do with sex, I can assure you. It's just a little dumpy town to the north that got great barbecue, but somebody knew that enough people were interested in that town and perhaps that place to place that into the computer in such a way that when you pull that up, that appeared. It's an example. And the internet, of course, is filled with it. It's a downfall for some of you sitting here today, I would imagine. I'd be surprised if there were not more than a few of you that struggle with sex on the internet. Whether it's a chat room or some site you have secretly found and you turn to. Years ago, you had to go to a dirty movie, or you had to sneak a peek at a magazine stand to look at it. Now you can see it in the privacy of your own home. Lock your door, pull your blinds, and you're all alone with it. And I need to tell you, I've never been more serious. It'll ruin you. It'll win. It'll conquer you. If you don't determine, I suggest in your years at this school to come to terms with it and to deal with it severely in your life, it'll conquer you. It'll take over. And you may not publicly fall, but you will lose the mental battle. It'll drain you. And as a result, it will cut in on your stride as a man or woman of God. David's fall, according to the record in 2 Samuel 11, where I want us to go, did not begin on his roof when he took a walk and he saw Bathsheba bathing. David's problem began earlier. David obviously is a man of enormous, enormous passion. No one could write like David can write, and that kind of passion works its way out in a number of different ways. And often the very gifted have the greatest battles in this area, and most of you are very gifted people. And you who have great imaginations will battle in this area as well. David was really something else. I would love, of all the biblical characters, I believe I would most love to have had time with David. I admire him for his accomplishments and for his tenderness, his love for God, his heart that just beat after God. I, of course, have consumed his songs, and they are music to my soul. Anyone can write like that, and often with the honesty with which he wrote, has my respect. David was a faithful man. He kept his father's sheep, and even after killing the giant, he doesn't, you know, run down to Macy's and try on crowns, thinking the kingdom is mine, certainly after Samuel anointed him. He went right back to the sheep. I love that. David was not important to David. Even though he became the greatest of Israel's kings, the flag flew over the nation with greater pride than ever before when David became king. One man writes rather cleverly, there was not only a chicken in every pot, but under David's rule, there were grapes on every vine. The prosperity was magnificent. The enemy feared Israel under David's rule, man of war, courageous, also loved many women. And against the teachings of the law, he took to his harem, if I count correctly, at least 17 wives, and along with that, many concubines. I'm confident his libido was intense. And though that's true, many women did not satisfy the man. The old feeling is that if you have enough women, you will be satisfied. There aren't enough women. Because with sex, there is always the thought of the unknown, and there is pleasure in the act of intercourse, regardless of who it is with, especially if your conscience is such that you can tolerate it outside of your marriage. Many people can. I was at a hotel with Cynthia, staying there for a conference, and interesting, there's a little sign, a little small, very well-written, beautiful calligraphy, "Have your next affair with us," right there on the table. It's everywhere. And David knew better, of course. We'll talk about that. But I want to build into it carefully, lest you think he just suddenly fell. No tree suddenly rots and collapses. No church suddenly splits. No marriage suddenly fractures. No life suddenly falls. It's a process. You're in the process. I'm in the process. It's always going on. And the enemy is so patient and brilliant. He'll take years and just drop a little here and there to keep you interested. Keep you curious. David served Saul, as all of you know from your study of the scriptures, and loved Saul's son like a brother, and he and Jonathan were just tight. And then at that battle on Mount Gilboa, they died. And David grieved the loss. Though Saul had haunted him and hunted him for years, David held him in respect. Another thing I admire. And so when he comes, if you have your Bible, 2 Samuel chapter 1, you find David now in grief, and as he was wont to do, he wrote a song. And it appears beautifully here in our Bibles. And the theme of the song, Aki naflu giborim bitok hamil kama. How the mighty are fallen in a day of battle. How the mighty are fallen. How the mighty are fallen. Says it three times in this one song. You see it in verse 19. You see it in verse 25. You see it in verse 27. How the mighty are fallen. And his heart breaks for the fact that he'll never again speak to Jonathan on earth. He'll never again know the joy of seeing tall, handsome Saul, his king. Never again. As best I can figure, David is about 30 at this time. And the mighty have fallen, and he writes about it. He has no idea what in the next 20 years would happen. But the success of David's life is like a rooftop on the rise. Never once a defeat in battle. Think of that. Never once did Israel lose a battle under David's rule. He expanded the borders from 6,000 to 60,000 square miles. And as I mentioned, the prosperity and the pride of the country, the patriotism, must have been magnificent. He built a beautiful home, his own palace, for him and his many wives. And he kept adding to his harem, and it kept weakening his soul. Life went on, but who was going to confront David, the fact that he had broken with what Moses had written? Who confronts a king like this? Which is part of the issue you will face as a leader. Especially if God blesses your life with success, as we measure success. And your ministry grows and your church becomes larger, or your outreach and influence becomes greater, and your teaching skills get even better, and your popularity grows, and you're a word on others' lips, and you're a household name in the country where you serve. Right now you sit here as a student, you think that's not going to, you have no idea what's going to be your future. You have no idea. That's why the decisions you make now and the habits you form now must be carefully managed, because you will carry them out in the days ahead like you can't believe. And if you have a wandering eye now, it will only intensify as you get older. and you never outgrow it. You never get too old for it. I remember sitting at a navigator conference when I was at Glen Eyrie, and Lauren Sanney, the president at the time, now gone, Lauren was interviewing an 86, 87-year-old missionary. And he said to him, "Tell me, brother so-and-so, when was it you gained victory over lust?" And the old guy said, "Well, Lauren, it hadn't happened yet." 86, 87-year-old guy still fighting lust. Of course. It's a drive that is if it's not guarded, if it's not monitored, it is uncontrollable. And in the most unbelievable times of your life, you can fall. I've had men minister in conferences where we were as a church, and while ministering behind the scenes, they are carrying on an affair with another woman, not their wife. One of them even chose as his subject for the conference moral purity while he is having an affair that later came out and pretty much finished him. Do not tell me that cannot happen. It's unbelievable. And his messages were spot on. I remember taking notes and talking with Cynthia about it after he would bring it. And I would say, "Did you get that? Listen to it." And I went, "Great insight. How the mighty are fallen." Don't forget those words. David did. So when you move from chapter 1 all the way to chapter 11, you're moving through one victory after another, after another, after another. And by the way, right in the back margin of your mind, 1 Corinthians 10, verse 12, "Let him who thinks he stands take heed lest he fall. Let her who thinks she stands take heed lest she fall." Every one of you can fall just like this man of God fell. And today it seems the farthest thing from your mind. I'm glad it does, but that's an unrealistic thought. Now, so much for my introduction. I wanted to get into it carefully and slowly, and I hope I've done that. We're not in a hurry, are we? They gave me a little extra time. I appreciate that, Patrick. Okay. 2 Samuel 5:13, I find, "Meanwhile, David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem after he came from Hebron." He took more wives. And if that wasn't enough, he took more concubines. Polygamy weakened him. His opinion poll was at an all-time high. Popularity rate was off the chart. Maximum power and prosperity. Luxurious lifestyle was his. The respect of his army. Joab, that cruel, tough to the bone soldier, was right there with him. David was his kind of guy. The palace and all of its conveniences, he had it made. And then that eventful evening arrived. It happened in the spring at the time when kings go out to battle. 2 Samuel 11:1a. He's a king, but he doesn't go out to battle. Why? We're not told. Probably thought Joab could handle this one. Who are the Amalekites? I mean, we could, half my army could whip them. They can take care of that. He should have been out there. By the way, lust doesn't grow when you're busily engaged in your work. Another one that works is running. Flee youthful lust. That works. You cannot lust and run at the same time. I remember being on Okinawa and they brought in 5,000 prostitutes to service the Marines as if we're animals. Well, many were. And I said to my mentor, how do I conquer the issue of temptation? Because when I get off the jitney and I've got to get up to your place for our Bible study, I got to walk by all these whorehouses where there, these beautiful women are out there waving and whistling and calling you in. And he said, run. You know what? I started doing that. And you know what? I didn't lust for any of them. My thought was, get out of the way. I'm trying to get up to Newkirk's place. But he lounges around. That's what you're going to do in some part of the next several weeks. Christmas comes. You have a little more time on your hands. I know you. You've got a lot of work to do, but you're gonna hang out a little, and that's when I get nervous for you. Those bad things happen when you hang out, and when you don't keep yourself occupied. I know what I'm talking about. Thankfully, I've never fallen, but there have been close calls. I was in Canada at a conference that lasted over the weekend, and I really was looking forward to watching a little football on TV, but they have hockey up there. And I know, if you're Canadian, so don't write me. I know, it's great. It's a goon sport, okay? I mean, these guys knock their teeth out, and the more blood, the better. Somebody said they watched a hockey game. It was boring until a fight broke out, and then all of a sudden it got good. So I was looking for a football magazine. There wasn't one, and I decided I'll go back to the room, get ready for the talk tomorrow. It was a Saturday, and I punched the elevator button, and two ladies got on with me. The door closed behind us, and I pushed floor 6, as I recall, and I looked at them, they didn't push a button, and I said, floor, and they said, 6 would be nice. Well, I felt a little like Tom Cruise all of a sudden. Or maybe Robert Redford, I'm a little closer to that age. And then, I'm honest, the shade drew, and my mother's voice revisited me as I read, "Be not deceived, God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap." No one knew me where I was. I was thousands of miles from home. Could have invited the ladies, the women in. And then when I finished, I was kind of staring, reading the verse in my mind, and they're looking at me like, so when the shade went up, I said, no thanks, I've got more than I can keep up with at home. And I stepped out and the door closed and they stayed on. And I leaned up against those marble walls and I thank God for the memorized scripture. Amen. That saved me from a fall. Amen. You would have never known it, but I would have lived with it. And I could have never talked on this. Or if I did, I'd have to fake it. And so David is lounging around the house. And he sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the sons of Ammon and besieged Rabbah. David stayed at Jerusalem. He's alone. He has time on his hands. And evening came. By the way, I did a little homework on evenings. Listen to David's words. Psalm 55, evening, morning, and noon, I will pray and cry aloud, and he will hear my voice. He will redeem my soul in peace from the battle which is against me. Psalm 55, 17 and 18. He wrote that. But he didn't do that this evening. Here's another one. Psalm 141, 2 through 4. May my prayer be counted as incense before you, the lifting up of my hands as the evening offering. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. Do not incline my heart to any evil thing. Or as one paraphrase puts it, the message, do not let me so much as dream of evil or thoughtlessly fall. Isn't that good? He forgot that this evening. Or maybe he wrote that after this evening. Here is our respected leader, the king like no other king, with an incredible record of faithfulness and refusal to retaliate against Saul, and courage in battle, took on the giant, and now became king. Best I can figure, he's about 50, maybe 55. I have an older son who's 55. And our kids go all the way down to 46. And he's Kurt's age, probably. I looked at Kurt the other day when we were together, and I thought about this. And I was so grateful that Kurt's been faithful to Debbie all these years. They have three kids. Oldest is 36, and they've got those grandkids now have kids. So I got, it looks like recess let out when we get all our family together. We got four kids, and we got 10 grandkids, and we got six great-grandkids. And they range in age all over. So when I travel, I carry a picture of my family, and I put it on the table where I eat. And if Cynthia can't go with me, I usually take someone else. And if no one else can, the picture is there. I even went on a cruise. Cynthia was not able to get over her back surgery, spine surgery, so I took a picture of her and showed everybody. This is who I'm with at this cruise. And you sleep with a picture, boy. It's ugly. I tell you, the corner of that thing digs into you. But there she was. I saw her every morning, and I looked at her at every meal. You don't lust easily when you got your wife looking you right in the eye, or your kids, or your grandkids, loving you, believing in you, counting on you, like Noah. Noah's 22 today, second day of boot camp in the Marine Corps. Yeah, 22. He put in for MARSOC, which is the Navy's answer to the SEALs, that's what the Marines are in MARSOC. Noah wants to do the toughest thing. I remember when he was growing up, when he wrote this little thing I'm going to show you. And all the grandkids call me Bubba. All the great-grandkids call me Great Bubba. So, Bubba and Great Bubba. So Noah is about, six, seven when he wrote this, when he drew this. And Noah put a little heart there, if you probably can't see it, but it says, I heart Bubba. He loves Bubba. Remember when Noah was about 12, he sat in front of me at my desk. I have a little small statue of the Marines that were lifting the flag on Iwo Jima. And he said, I won't be a Marine. I said, do you? He said, yeah. I said, why? He said, well, I want to be a sniper. I want to kill people. I said, no. Sit down, Noah, sit down. So Noah sat down and he said, well, that's what you were and that's what you did. No. I said, I was in the Corps, but I didn't kill people. Wanted to, but I didn't kill people. And he left. I found that on my desk this morning here at the seminary. I got a grandson that loves me. And I hope he does. He's now in boot camp, so. I pray for Noah. He's going through it right now. What am I saying? I am saying David forgot all of that. Every bit of it. Every child. Every wife. Worse, his God. Listen to what Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote about temptation. In our members, there is a slumbering inclination toward desire, which is both sudden and fierce. With irresistible power, desire seizes mastery over the flesh all at once. A secret smoldering fire is kindled. The flesh burns and is in flames. It makes no difference whether it is sexual desire or ambition or vanity or desire for revenge or love of fame or power or greed for money. Joy in God is extinguished from us as we seek all our joy in the creature. At this moment, this is so insightful. At this moment, God is quite unreal to us, and only desire for the creature is real. Satan does not here fill us with hatred of God, but with forgetfulness of God. Isn't that great? David didn't hate God. He just forgot him. The lust thus aroused envelops the mind and will in deepest darkness. The powers of clear discrimination and decision are taken from us. It is here that everything within me rises up against the word of God. That is profound. That is the height of lust. That makes even a monarch like David stare at a woman taking a shower in her backyard. When evening came, David arose from his bed and walked around on the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman. You know the first recorded words from the mouth of Samson? I saw a woman. I call Samson a he-man with a she weakness. At this moment, that's David. He doesn't think about battles won. He doesn't think about the faithfulness of his God. He doesn't think about the trust of his children, his Noah. He's thinking about one thing. Every man in this room knows exactly what he's thinking. He doesn't have to undress her. She's already. In fact, look, he saw a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful in appearance. Trust me, when the scripture says very beautiful, she is gorgeous. And he stares. And he wants her. He's got all these women. All these concubines. He wants her. Because he's never had her. So David went and inquired about the woman. By the way, she was his neighbor, and he'd never met her. Busy about the king's business, I can understand that. And one who he talked to said to him, listen to this answer. Is this not Bathsheba, the daughter of Eliam, the wife of Uriah the Hittite? That's unusual. When genealogies are given in the scriptures, usually it's the father named and the grandfather, sometimes the great-grandfather. Rarely is the mate mentioned. That servant also is looking. And he knows David, what's in his mind. Every man knows other men in this way. And he says, she's married, David. She's a married woman. And not just married, she's married to one of your mighty men, Uriah the Hittite. Someday, Dr. Bailey, you need to have Reg Grant. Is Reg here? Reg was on one of our cruises, and he does Uriah. That is a knockout presentation. Because he does it all from the perspective of Uriah, who trusts his king, who can't bear the thought of even touching his wife while his men are in battle, who doesn't cooperate with the king, even when the king gets him drunk. And then finally, he gets his death warrant handed to him, folded up, put in a pouch. And as Reg puts this, he pats the pouch. He says, I have the message from the king to go to my commander, Joab, and I will take that message. And you want to go, no. Don't. It's so real. I just want you to have Reg do that sometime. Line him up. To do Uriah. Oh, I sound like the hot shot here. Please, if you don't mind. Anyway, it's really worth it. Okay. David sent and inquired. They said she's Uriah's wife. And David sent messenger. Yeah, that didn't stop him. To know that she's somebody else's wife, it doesn't stop you when you're full of lust. Nothing stops you. I'm telling you, men, I can only speak to you. I don't know how it works with a woman, but I'll tell you, you go blind. He didn't even know her name. He was already lusting. And he sent messengers, and he took her, and when she came in, he lay with her. When she had purified herself from her uncleanness, she returned to her house. Probably left that night. Done. Not quite. Stolen waters are sweet, and I'm sure on that bed it was ecstasy for just a few moments. Worth that? Worth all of that? Never. F.B. Meyer writes, this is the bitterest of all, to know that suffering need not have been. That it has resulted from indiscretion and inconsistency and neglect. That it is the harvest of one's own sowing. That the vulture which feeds on the vitals is the nestling of one's own rearing. Ah, me, this is pain. You hear that? How the mighty have fallen. 20 years' time, he forgot his own line. Because sex is that powerful. She returned to her own house. I could take time here to speak to you women, and probably should say a few words. Be really careful, ladies. We are very vulnerable men. Dress yourself very carefully. Conduct yourself without flirting. Don't go there. Save it all for your husband. And that's all I need to say. You are lovely ladies, and you have a future that's beautiful. And I can't help but mention Bathsheba was not raped. She came. I know people obeyed the king. She didn't have to say yes to this. There is no fight. She was lonely, and she missed her husband. David was available. That's kind of the way it works, because both forget about God. And the woman conceived and sent and told David and said, I am pregnant. Now, I'm not through until I mention four things that I want you to remember. No one ever said this to me when I was a seminary student. Thankfully, by God's grace and the love of a magnificent wife and good training by great parents, the grace of God that preserved me all the way through my hitch in the Marine Corps, all the way through these years in ministry, by the grace of God, Noah won't have to say, I no longer respect Bubba. By the grace of God. To keep from thinking we're safe, let me give you two comments. First, acknowledge your weakness. Acknowledge your weakness. And second, guard your leisure. You will be trusted with privacy. Be careful about that. Acknowledge your weakness. Guard your leisure. And now, to keep from falling, two final things. Number one, remain accountable. I carry accountability questions that we ask in our accountability group periodically to the other men in the group. Have you been with a woman anywhere this past week that might be seen as compromising? Answer that question. Have you exposed yourself to any sexually explicit material? Answer that question. Surf the net, secretly developing this. You hide explicit material. I don't know how many men have told me they started in pornography because of the stack of pornography magazines that their dad had. And that started them on the journey. Have you spent adequate time in your own personal study of the scriptures and prayer? Have you given priority time to your family? The last question is the killer. Have you just lied to me? Called being accountable. You accountable to anybody? Willingly, deliberately, consistently. Remain accountable, and finally, rehearse the consequences. Sitting in this room, we're all safe. Sitting in this room, the lights are on. Sitting in this room are people who know us. Sitting in this room, we are, for one of the few places in life, in the majority. We love Jesus. He is our master. He's our redeemer. He's our Lord. Your battle doesn't come in this room. It comes in the darkness of your own mind and the privacy of your own life. I'll look over all these other things. I want to read you something. Consequences of a Moral Tumble, Randy Alcorn. Whenever I feel particularly vulnerable to sexual temptation, I find it helpful to review what effects my action could have. And he lists them. Listen to this list. Grieving the Lord who redeemed me, dragging his sacred name into the mud, following in the footsteps of these people whose immorality forfeited their ministries and caused me to shudder, list their names. Inflicting untold hurt on Nancy, my best friend and loyal wife. Losing Nancy's respect and trust. Hurting my beloved daughters, Karina and Angie. And when I read my children's names. Kurt and Carissa, Colleen and Chuck. Who believe in me. Who trust me. Destroying my example and credibility with my children and nullifying both present and future efforts to teach them to obey God. Why listen to a man who betrayed Mom and us? If my blindness should continue or my wife be unable to forgive, perhaps losing my wife and my children forever. Consequences continue. Losing self-respect. Creating a form of guilt awfully hard to shake. Even though God would forgive me, would I ever forgive myself? Forming memories and flashbacks that could haunt me and future intimacy with my wife. Wasting years of ministry training and experience for a long time, maybe permanently. Forfeiting the effective years of witnessing to my father and reinforcing his distrust for ministers because of my fall. Undermining the faithful example and hard work of other Christians in our community, bringing great pleasure to Satan, the enemy of God and all that is good. Heaping judgment and endless difficulty on the person with whom I committed adultery. Possibly bearing the physical consequences of such diseases as gonorrhea, syphilis, chlamydia, herpes, and AIDS, perhaps infecting Nancy for the rest of her life. That's enough. This has been the autopsy of a moral fall. God tells us the truth. Don't you ever forget it. Don't ever forget it. Don't ever forget this message. And may he keep you pure and faithful, whether married or single, younger or older, involved in ministry or some phase of ministry or some secular role, whatever, may he keep you faithful. May your grandson always be able to leave you a note like this. Our Father, we confess to you that we are mere human beings. We are mere women and men. We are not super people. The same nature that beat in the heart of David beats in ours. And there it is every day to meet us, every morning, with fresh, lurid temptations. An enemy ready to pounce, patiently waiting for the moment when that man or that woman comes along and no one else will know at that time. Hold us close to yourself, dear Father. May we never, ever forget these words, how the mighty are fallen. In the name of Christ, our Master, our Redeemer.